First and foremost, I want to say thank you to all of y'all who send me emails, tips, info. Like this one from NightNurse71 talking about Brian's car and how it didn't have dark tinted windows. Excellent observation. And to me, truly important, because this, again, is the snapshot of the car that was speeding by the gas station at what time? Like 2:45 in the morning, right?
Looking like you're racing home to take a shit.
Clearly dark tint on these windows, right? I mean, it's literally like the color of the asphalt. Yet, when Kohberger and his dad are stopped in Indiana, you can tell his windows rolled up here. The cop couldn't hear him, so he rolled his window up. There is no tint on his windows. Second of all, I want to just show you really quickly why it is. I don't watch other people's videos, okay? I know on more than one occasion, people have mentioned this one YouTube channel, okay? And I'm just going to play it for you. And then I'm going to show you where the problem is.
Clickbait.
This obituary. And look, right here. Beat Brian K. from Moscow, Idaho, wrote on February 19, 2023, RIP, my dear friend. And the tips that I got was like, this could be Brian Kohberger. Again, is this somebody trolling to pretend they're Brian Kohberger, or is it not even Brian Kohberger, but another Brian K? Could it be Brian Kopaka, or another, somebody with a different last name with K? But it's just so strange that a Brian K and an Emma Bailey would sign the guest book.
So this particular person said that he kept getting tips to look at Brent Kopaka's obituary, right? And I have to say, it's almost a little terrifying at the lack of the ability to look at something and see, oh yeah, this is nothing. I can assure you that Brian did not write on this page on February 19th. He was in jail. Oh, sleuthing on a Sunday. So we all know, thanks to the newest warrants, that Kohberger was a runner. And as usual, there's many parts to the point I'm trying to make, but ultimately it ends in a great one. So just keep up. All right, we're going to start here with this guy, Christian Martinez. Martinez lived across this hall from Kohberger and said he remembered Brian moving to the area in the summer of 22. Martinez gave an interview, I believe it was to Law and Crime, and was talking about how he met his dad in the parking lot. He just stopped him and started talking to him. He was wanting to introduce him to Brian, and he couldn't remember exactly what he described him, like a word he used to describe him, but basically he was telling him he had a hard time making friends and was kind of shy. So the way Martinez describes Brian after the incident on King Road was days after it happened, he brought it up when he saw him in the hallway. Which, when you hear that, makes it sound a little strange, like, Brian, why are you talking about this? Whatever. Until you go to his next statement, where he then explains that Brian really liked talking to him in the hall, and he would talk about his studies, like forensics and criminology. And he said at the time, it just seemed like normal. So one thing I want to interject about this Martinez person, he felt like he wanted to hang out with Kohberger, whatever, should have hung out with him because he quoted to Law and Crime. It kind of made me feel bad because I was like one of the people that he made friends with. What if it would have made a difference if I had been able to meet up with him the times that I could have. Maybe that would have changed anything. But what's funny to me is if you look at this text message string that Martinez provided to Law and Crime, it kind of looks like Kohberger left him hanging, not the other way around. So here's where it gets fun. After they were first introduced, right, so he moves there in June, the end of June. I'm thinking this probably took place sometime in July. Martinez invited Kohberger to a pool party. And at that pool party, Kohberger met a guy named Zach Cartwright for the first time. So naturally, Zach was interviewed about the pool party that they went to together. And he recounted noticing him and noticing that he was kind of standing off the whole time, wasn't very social, which he found weird because it was a party and people were interacting. And he said Brian was just kind of standoffish. And I don't have the slide up here, but I remember in part of that interview, Zach saying that he was just very observant talking about Brian. Why is the observant bit important? Well, Cartwright said it was strange how quickly Kohberger recognized him the next time their paths crossed. Well, let's just go back and look at what you said. He was standing off by himself and was very observant. So someone in his field of study, that's for me how they should act, right? It's almost like training yourself at all times to be really good at your job. So in regards to the next time that their paths crossed, right? Cartwright said it was really weird how Brian approached him and the people that he was with because he acted kind of like they were best friends. He said it was like a reunion type of encounter and that Brian was really excited to see us. And Cartwright said that he didn't even have any idea really who Brian was right then. I told a lie. Here's a slide about the observant thing. My bad. But anyway, so Cartwright went on to say he did seem kind of socially awkward and kind of hard to carry a conversation with, if he remembers correctly, okay? But he said besides that, he mainly kept to the side and was really observant. So much so that based on the one interaction they had that day, Brian knew exactly who he was maybe a month or so later. And this is the important part. When I saw him on that hike. So the two small interactions, right, that Cartwright and Kohberger had proved to be pretty important because Cartwright was interviewed by the FBI. Cartwright made the statement, I did speak to the FBI at one point. I do believe that they spoke to a lot of people that were at that party. And important part here again, maybe because that was one of his very first times, if not his first time in Moscow. So the pool party obviously took place in Moscow, not Pullman, right, where Martinez and Kohberger lived. But Martinez was the one that invited him to the pool party. But again, important to note, it was in Moscow. So I want to go back and talk about the running, okay? The Strava app that Kohberger may or may not have used more than one time. The only trip that we have access to is one trip, one run. It took place on August 4th, 2022, and it was at 12:45 a.m. He ran for 1.38 miles. Now, I've heard all this, seen all this to do about, I mean, what are you doing running at 12:45 in the morning? Blah, blah, blah. Well, I don't know about y'all, but like, grown-ups typically have crap to do during the day. You know what I mean? Like, we work, our days are filled, right? And I want to point out, too, that this is not the first time we've heard from people surrounding Kohberger that he was a night owl. Remember the lady that allegedly lived under him said that she just got so mad because he would vacuum all the time and it would be like at 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning. I mean, obviously there's a pattern of him being awake at nighttime, and not just that, not just being awake at nighttime, but also running.
I used to go on night runs with him because, like, I didn't want to go running at night by myself. So I would text him, like, hey, you want to go for a run? We'd go for 6-7 mile runs at night. So, like, when I saw who it was, I was just in, like, complete shock.
So naturally, my nosy ass was like, okay, are there any, like, hiking trails in Moscow? Because we just saw where Zach Cartwright said he ran into Kohberger on a hike. And again, he's a runner. So what you see on the screen are all hiking trails around Moscow. But we're going to focus on one in particular. And that is the Charles Houston Shattuck, I can't see, it's far away, sorry, Arboretum. So this is pretty much like you go, you run, you look at flowers and trees, right? But it's also known as the University of Idaho Arboretum. And if you look, it says open 24 hours. Oddly enough, the loop distance, which goes all the way around the Arboretum, is approximately 1.4 miles. Literally the exact distance of the run we have access to that Kohberger did on August 4th, 1.38 miles. And it says, please remember, no pets or active sports are allowed. An active sport to me is running. I don't run unless someone's chasing me. Somebody says 5-0 police, I'll run then. But could it be he's running at night? If he goes somewhere like this place, he goes at night so he can run. So let's just look in relative distance to where this Arboretum is and the King Road House. Right here is the Arboretum. And right here is 1122 King Road. So this is an overall map of the Arboretum that's right beside of King Road. If we zoom in, we can see that there is an entrance and obviously an exit right there on Palouse River. Now, I want to look at a statement that was in the affidavit from Brett Payne. He says, based on my knowledge of the area and review of camera footage in the neighborhood that does not show suspect vehicle 1 during that time frame, I believe that suspect vehicle 1 likely exited the neighborhood at Palouse River Drive and Conestoga Drive. Conestoga is literally just to the east of the Arboretum. But for me, it's the wording here, I believe and likely. Those are not definitive statements, right? They're opinions, actually, verbatim opinions of someone. So if we look at this map, right? On August 21st of 22, Kohberger was stopped by an officer, okay? His cell phone showed he was in Moscow, just in Moscow, okay? Just a cell phone ping. This location right here is 1122 King Road. And he's, again, just pinging the one cell phone tower for Moscow. This location right here is the Arboretum. So, in my opinion, yes, he's been there. There's this big to-do. He was stalking them, blah, blah, because he had been there 12 times. Well, I can already tell you if he was, he only stalked them 11 times because I've just learned of one time he was in Moscow and he was at a party with other people. Seen there, verified. So is it really possible that, yeah, they saw his car on Walenta and he was just going for a run? What I do find interesting is every single time something comes out in the paperwork, somebody saying something, whatever, it's all to prove that BK is guilty, right? But every single thing that comes out almost winds up giving him like more of an alibi or chances to give an alibi or just pokes more holes in the affidavit and the story that we've gotten so far. And I'm out like a Dollar Tree light bulb.